Welcome drivers to the interior of the Volvo VNM. Just be going over some basic operations of the VNM interior. Whether you're a new driver or experienced driver, it's just to basically help you out, give you a little info so when you jump into the truck, you're a little familiar with how these gauges work and you're not being surprised by anything. The interior of your truck might look a little different than mine depending if you have the raised roof or the mid roof with the fairing. This is the raised roof version. So we'll start here. There's your key switch. Of course, turn it back for the auxiliary power. Turn it forward once to engage the computers, the motor, get it ready to prime. And then you turn it forward to start the engine, get the motor running. Of course, your gauges, instrument panel, your boost pressure gauge, temperature gauge, oil pressure, diesel exhaust fluid level, RPM gauge, fuel level gauge, speedometer, air pressure gauges, and your air application gauge. Now, with the Volvos, you won't get the old arm pump horn. To engage the air horn, you push the center. These two on the side here are your electric city horns. And going down the side here, of course, your window buttons, up, down. This is your mirror adjustment buttons, left, right. That'll light up. You can't really see it right now, but those will light up whichever one you have on. Then you move the lever to adjust the mirrors. This is your mirror heat, your door lever, push forward to lock. That's a neutral position. Pull back to open the door. Of course, your tractor parking brake, trailer air supply. Over here are your rear of the tractor service lights. If you need to light up the back there when you're hooking up to a trailer or hooking up your airlines or whatnot, slip that down, the little light will come on and the lights will be on in the back. Just make sure you always turn that off when you're rolling down the road, especially bobtail, or somebody will let you know pretty quick that you got your lights on. Because when this is on, you do not get a notification on the dash that that is on. It's just that right there, and it can be hard to see from where you're driving at. So just always make sure you, if you turn those on, you turn them off. This is your sleeper dome light. Push down to turn on, push up to turn off, just to make sure it's on. If you hit it twice, it'll give you a little beep letting you know it's on, and then the beep again just to confirm that it's off. And then over here is your sleeper fan. Down for low speed, up for high speed. That'll light up when you actually have the fan engaged. That'll go up to 4 speeds, and when you're at the max speed, it'll beep as well. And when it's completely off, it'll beep as well, letting you know it's off. Going to the switches over here, we'll go over this first. It's your mobile eye, of course, just letting you know the distance, stopping distance between you and the vehicle in front of you. Just making sure that you're safe and all. You can't mess around with this too much, but you can adjust the volume and the brightness. And to adjust the volume, just when it's sitting like this, you either hit these plus or minus buttons on the side. And to adjust the brightness, it'll be this first one here. And you can adjust the brightness of that that way. The other ones you can't mess around with. Dart locked them in for their settings. This right here is the differential lock. It's a safety switch, so you don't want to engage that when you're rolling down the freeway, that's for sure. This will just give you some extra traction when backing up into the trailer, or if you need to help yourself get rolling a little bit. You just flip that down, the tractor will beep at you, and this little thing will come up on the dash letting you know that it's engaging. This is to turn your traction control off. If for ever any reason you need to feel like you need to keep spinning the tires, you just hold that button down and you can keep spinning the tires. This is your electronic controlled suspension button. for this. This will raise and lower the airbags, and to do that, flip that switch down, and then you go over to this one here. A little notification will come up on there too, the information that your airbag switch is engaged, and you can either raise the airbags or lower them. Of course, when you're dropping a trailer, always lower them. This is your marker interrupter switch, or the thank you switch. And when a driver flashes you to signal you're clear to go over, you can, you know, get that down, and that'll cut the power to the marker lights on the tractor and the high profile lights on the trailer. Sometimes that doesn't work with older trailers, though. Usually to say thank you, I just go ahead and hit the hazards, let them flash a couple times. But yeah, that's what that does. Temperature and air control gauges here. These are pretty simple. Air conditioning on or off. Cycle the air through the cab button right here. Fan speed, temperature, and where you want the air coming out of. Just a little hint here. In the winter time, I know it can either get really hot or really cold in the cab quick, so you're always messing around with the temperature, but what I find is best when I'm just rolling down the road, cruising, driving along, I'll put my settings here on the bi-level mode, and I'll put the temperature about right there, and I'll just keep the fan on off. I usually found that to be pretty comfortable in the winter time, even with the light jacket on. Of course, settings are completely up to you, but if you want to give that a try, go ahead. Here's your radio. Pretty simple operation, but I will show you a neat little feature on here. If you hit that radio button and go to weather, you'll get the old robot voice telling you the weather in the area. So if you're rolling down the road and you think you might be hitting some weather, yeah, you can either pull over, stop, look at your phone, or you can keep rolling, listen to the radio. Of course, there's different frequencies for that, just depending on what area you're in. Just keep scanning until you find something. Every area's got one. Most areas got one, I should say. So if you ever need a quick checkup on the weather, there you go. Now coming over here, of course, you got your CB hookup. Power ground antenna cable here. These two things should either be placed on the window or up on the dash somewhere. This is your easy pass. That'll work on toll booths on the East Coast or any toll booth that will take an easy pass. Just ride on through. That'll scan it. Everything's good, just as long as it's in a visible area in the windshield. This is your pre-pass for scale houses to test this, just to make sure it's working. Hit the little blue button here, and those will flash, and it'll beep. Now, when you're going through a pre-pass site, as long as you go through the sensor, this should trigger as long as they have it on at the scale house. When you're clear to go through, this green light will appear on the side, and it will beep 3 or 4 times, very steady, long beeps. If they want you to pull in, a red one will appear on the side here. And when the red one activates, it will be 3 to 4 quick beeps. And then you'll have to pull into the scale house, and they'll either bypass you or weigh you. But that's how the pre-pass works. Of course, over here, you got your 12-volt power outlets. Coin tray, I guess. Extra cup holders up there. Holders right by the driver's side there. And coming over here, we'll go over some functions on this. This is your engine brake, Jake brake, compression brake, whatever you want to call it. How this works on the automatic is if you pull it down once, that'll go into automatic mode. And you'll see that notification on the dash there. A for automatic means it'll sync it with the cruise control, that if you're going down a hill and you go 2 miles over this, what your cruise is synced at, it'll engage the engine brake and slow you down. Pull it down once, that'll activate 40% of the engine brake. Pull it down twice is 70%, and the third time is 100%. And if you pull it down a fourth time in the automatic, it will shift down. So always make sure that you're not pulling it down too far. In some cases, you don't want to be over revving the engine. And then all the way up is off, of course, and it'll tell you that right there. And I remember, if you're not in automatic mode with cruise control on, if you have the cruise control on and you switch down to 1, 2, or 3, that will disengage your cruise control and you will have to re-engage it later to get back to cruising speed. But then, of course, over here, your cruise control lever, that will turn it on, and then these buttons on the side here will set your cruise control, and it will appear up on here how fast you can go. Dark governs your max cruise control at 64 miles an hour. And of course, if you push this button over, that'll resume your cruise speed if you hit the brakes or have to stop or engage the engine brake or whatever. And of course, pull back for bright lights, signal left, right. Pretty simple there. And this side, this will be your wipers, low and high speeds, and then the intermittent speed on the up position, and you pull back to get the sprayer going. Now, another thing with the Volvo is, you know, they got the little fancy heads-up display here. So I'll just show you a couple features on there. To engage that, this is the enter button, this the escape is the back button, and then these will go up and down through the menu. So to activate that, we'll go ahead and hit the enter button here, and hopefully you can see that pretty good. And we'll go into gauges, that top one up there, and this will just cycle through your gauges, your outside temperature, other various gauges. The ones I usually use the most are outside temperature and this one right here, the pressure on the airbags. Just a little hint, of course, anything over 30,000 pounds, DART recommends, and you should, scale it out just to make sure you're within the legal limit weights. Scale out anything you want to, you know, it's up to you. But what I find that helps is, on my tractor at least, you know, get to know your tractor, that before I head onto the scale when I'm adjusting my tandems, if I can get that to 60 psi or under, I'm usually pretty good. Never guaranteed, but that's usually something to help you gauge it out. So hopefully you can only pull on the scale once, you're within a good limit, and you can get rolling. If not, you'll have to adjust. But like I said, 60 psi or under, usually pretty good, but don't quote me on that. Like I said, you get to know your tractor and scale out anything you have in doubt, because trust me, you know, $10 scale ticket is a lot better than a $300 overweight ticket. Another thing that I like to go into is the fuel data, and with this you'll notice that the Volvo will give you a performance bonus. That, of course, you can always set the cruise control at 64 miles an hour. However, if you reach your performance bonus, you can go 65, which can make the difference when you're trying to pass someone. And to achieve that fuel performance bonus, these numbers have to be different from the one up there. The first one is your average mileage. I was running empty, so of course it's up there quite a ways. But the 6.3, if it falls below that, you won't meet your performance bonus. You got to get above 6.3. The second one is idle time. It has to be under 25. If your idle time is over 25, you won't achieve your performance bonus. And this is the sweet spot monitoring. That just has to be above 85. But basically the two big ones are the idle time and the mileage. And if you do not achieve the performance bonus, it usually can take up to an hour or two for the engine to get a good read to make sure you're meeting that performance bonus so you can go a little faster. But that's what that's all about there. And that'll tell you how much gallons you have left in the tank and about average mileage. Course, can change your clock time here, and we'll just go back to the main menu there. Of course, if you want to learn more about that, your truck should have the operations manual in it. You can read through that. Another thing up here, dome light, map light. Cool thing with the dome light is you can sync it to that it turns on when you open up the door. So as you can see, I pushed the button several times there. The last time it'll just flat out turn it on, that'll turn it off, but I'll hit that button again, nothing will happen. But when I open up the door, it turns on. Now, the same will go for your footwell light. You can either turn that on manually, or you can sync it with the door. Light switch buttons here. That's the off position. That'll be for your running, parking lights. That'll turn the headlights on. Of course, pull back on that to activate the bright lights. This is the instrument panel dimmer, dim, bright, and of course your safety hazard lights button right there. Here's your seat controls. For the air pressure in the seat, that'll raise it up and down. The rest will kind of adjust the cushions. Do that however you please to your liking. The back cycler, what it'll do is it'll push that center thing in and out. I don't know, massage your back, whatever you want to do with that. You can also adjust with these levers on the side, this lever in the front here. And this will be your steering wheel. Tilt, of course, accelerator, brake, automatic, and then, well, this actually, a lot of new drivers ask me, well, how do I open up the hood? I don't see the latches on the outside. Of course, Volvo's got to do everything different. So your hood latch is right here. You just pull that all the way out, and that'll prop the hood. Fire extinguisher is usually located right there. And your automatic transmission, pretty simple. Reverse, drive, and then manual mode. Manual mode is disabled, so if you pop it in manual, it'll be the same thing as drive. But you will need to use that for a different feature on this. I'll tell you about that in a little bit. But the plus and minus is for the manual mode. Doesn't matter, they don't work. If you push this button down here, you can flip that all the way down so you can move to the back easier. Just pull it back up. There you go. This is economy performance mode. I believe that one's disabled too. And the button on the back there is the limp home mode. For any reason your truck has a major problem that's not DEF related, what you can do is pop her down in manual, hit the limp home mode button, and you got to select a gear. A gear mode will go 1, 3, and 5, and that'll basically get you rolling at about 5 miles an hour or whatever, just to get you to a safe area. Say, you know, you're broke down on the side of the road, but the truck can still move. That's what you'll use limp mode for, to get up to an on-ramp or anything like that. But of course, if you do a breakdown, call Road Ready, ask them if it's okay to do that. Let's go over some basic functions of the sleeper berth control panel here. Temperature gauge. This is your dome light. Turn that on or off. Here's your fan button. That'll show you the fan speed on the display there. It goes up to 4. And the fan vents are located up there. One on the back side there. And right there as well. Now, one of the most important features on here, especially in the winter, is the bunk heater. And to activate the sleeper bunk heater, the electrical heater, you'll hit the menu button and it will go through some options. And you're going to want to go to the one where it says heat on the top. then you hit the on button here, and then set. And that'll take a while to kick in, about a minute or so, but when it does, the heat will blow out of a vent down there, and you can move this around too. As far as I know, there's only one heat setting for it, and that's hot. And then to turn it off, just do the steps again. Go to menu until you see heat, says off, set, and that'll turn it off. There are other menu options in here too. You can set the alarm, timer, lamp timer. Just play around with it, figure it out. You can also set the clock back here too. This is just a fuse panel down here, some fuses in there. The panic button, that will activate the electric city horn. If you hold that down, you gotta hold it down for a couple seconds, and it will continually sound the city horn. To turn that off, you just hold it down again, or get up front, start the truck, hit the horn buttons, whatever. This is just a little speaker on this side. And this one right here, this is the low voltage warning. There's a little red light behind there that'll start blinking red when it feels that the batteries are getting low on voltage. When that happens, that'll blink for a minute, and it'll cut off all auxiliary power, meaning that none of these 12 volt outlets will work. And to when that happens, just start up your truck, let it run for a half hour, get those batteries charged up again. That'll happen more commonly in the winter, especially when you're running the bunk heater. The bunk heater, that will go for about a good 4 or 5 hours before you need to go ahead, start up the truck, get those batteries charged up again. Got a 112 volt outlet right here. I got that hooked up to a cooler, and I highly recommend, you know, if you're a road driver, getting yourself a cooler. I got this one on sale actually for $50, but a decent cooler will run you anywhere from $50 to $100. But of course, you know, the good nice refrigerator ones are up there in price as well. Just got a little light right there, another light right there, and of course your dome light. Got the raised roof speakers are up there. They don't work because there's no speakers in them. If yours work and they got speakers in them, good for you, more power to you. You get to enjoy some music back here, but I can't because there's no speakers behind them. You open up the door here. Most of your service manuals will be up in here. There's another 12 volt power outlet up there. But about the service manual, your truck should have these. If not, contact your fleet manager or safety lane. Just make sure you have the manuals in here, because they're a good thing to read through. Get to know your truck, learn about the operations. Good time to read these. Let's say it's taking a while to get loaded, you're waiting in line, got some time to kill. Go ahead and read through that. Get to know your truck. You can lift the bed up in the sleeper berth, and to do that, there is a lever down here. You just pull that, and then you'll be able to lift up on the bed. That will lift the bed up, and that will also expose the baggage doors there. Cabin air filter back there. Try not to block that. These right here, those are for the safety harness that latch up there. Got my safety harness stored up here. If you're team driving in shifts and someone's back here when the vehicle's rolling, that's what you'll need the safety harness for. Now to open up your baggage door, there's a little cord right there. Now you actually gotta pull that, hold on to it, then reach over and lift over the baggage door while you're still pulling on that. It's just a little safety latch. Now obviously, things you should have in here: at least 2 load straps. It's a company driver, you can get those from the safety lane. Washer fluid, jug of antifreeze, and a jug of oil. Pro Stop will get those for you. As you can see, I have several load straps in here. If you come across some in a trailer, keep them. You never know if you'll be relaying a load that you have to keep your load straps in, and you just lost those load straps. That's why you always keep load straps on you, so you're never out of them, but you always got to have two with you. A couple other things, your kingpin lock and trailer padlock, company driver, Dart will supply those for you. Another thing, the stay rat. Dart will provide that for you if you're a company driver. It's good to have one of those anyway. Fifth wheel puller. I bought my own, plan on keeping it. The truck didn't come with one. Like I said, I bought my own. It's mine. I get to keep it. I don't know if Dart will provide you with one, but you'll have to talk to your fleet manager or safety lane about that. Some wire snips for snipping seals. This isn't a very good one, but it works good enough. If you can find a good one, go ahead and get that. Some light duty zip ties. Heavy duty zip ties. Electrical tape. Air pressure gauge. You always need one of these. I bought my own. This one's mine. Just a hammer for whatever. Bigger the better. This one isn't much, but it's something. Another thing I have in here is just some ice melt, traction melt. In the winter time, what I like to do, if you get in a minor situation where your tires are spinning and you're not going anywhere, just take some of this, throw it in front of the tire there, and I mean like really scrape it in front of the tire there, and that should give you enough traction to get the tractor rolling. Just always make sure you have a plan for when you get rolling that you don't stop right away and get stuck again. Of course, that's just the quick way to get out of there. But yeah, that's got me out of a few pinches in the winter, just to carry some type of granular type of traction assist to get you out of tight situations. Kitty litter, sand, whatever. I just like using the ice melt. Now on the outside of the tractor, the power switch is located under here. You can flip that on or off. And there is the engine heater. When it's cold out in the winter, you'll want to plug her in. That's where that is. Another thing you should have on you, just a little mini shovel in case you need to get out of a tight situation. Another thing, a broom. You got the handle there, you know, screws into the broom, of course. I bought my own. That one's mine. I'm keeping it. If Dart's going to provide you with one, like I said, talk to Safety Lane or your fleet manager, see if they can get you one or reimburse you for it. Just remember, if you buy it for the truck, it stays with the truck. It's Dart's property. Emergency devices right there, your triangles and whatnot. This button here will activate the light in the back. Another thing about the broom, you will need one because there are customers that will require you to sweep out a trailer, and some of them do not have brooms in sight. Some of them will not let you sweep out the trailer on site. I know Whirlpool is one of them, so it's always nice to have your own broom with you because you will need it and you don't want to be rejected a load because you didn't have a broom and you couldn't clean out your trailer. Another thing that will come in handy, a long type ice scraper, snow brush. Of course, some other tools that will help you out on your adventures out there. Super glue, ratcheting wrench set, various pliers, cutters, adjustable pliers, duct tape, flashlight, twist ties. Always save your twist ties with the plastic bags in case you have to drop a trailer and there's no pouch for the manifest. You'll have to tie it to one of the airlines. But either way, I always put my manifests in the plastic bag, even if there is a pouch. That way everything stays dry and clean. Just some spare wire, multi-tool, knife in it, lock de-icer. You know, in the wintertime, always carry that in your pocket. You don't want to leave that in the truck and have your lock ice up when you're outside and this is in the truck. And of course, some window cleaner for your mirrors. Just some basic tools to help you out, get you better prepared for when you start driving or, you know, if you're a current driver and just need something new. Other useful items here, just some scrubbing wipes in case your hands get dirty, scrub them off quick with these. Some fifth wheel lubricant, any type you want, in the grease gun or the packets or this. WD-40, small can of that. Extension cord for your engine block heater in the winter. Plug the truck in when it's cold out, that way you can start it up right away. And just some utility gloves. And any type of gloves will do. Your preference really, but just a few other items help you get started when you get out on the road there. Roll of paper towels or shop towels, whatever you like. It's always good to have a roll around. Of course, a few other things you're gonna need: safety vest, safety camera, spare fuses, safety regulation book, hazmat book, PeopleNet information packet, and your permit book. Dart can provide you with all these. You might have to buy the safety vest on your own though. I got my own. But yeah, the safety camera, fuses, the manuals and all that, just make sure you always have those. If not, contact your fleet manager or safety or stop in at the safety lane. Make sure you have all these on you. Of course, another handy tool to have on hand is a power inverter. This one's just a 400 watt. It's good enough to charge my laptop and cell phone at the same time. However, you know, if you're going to be running the TV and the Xbox and all that stuff, you might want to get the a bigger one, you know, 2000 watt or better. But these range about $50 for a 400 watt, but you can definitely at least get a 400 watt one so you can keep your cell phone or laptop or whatever charged up. And of course, you know, it just plugs in your 12 volt there. You will also need a paper logbook with you. If your PeopleNet unit ever goes down, your e-logs go down, you'll need to revert to paper logs. You can either get one at the truck stop or Dart can provide you one at the terminal. You always got to make sure you have one of these with you though, in case PeopleNet goes down. You also need these with you. Trip packs, make sure you have several of those. Straight bills of lading. You'll need these if you're relaying a load and you need to leave the bills paperwork with it. You'll need to manually fill out this to put in the trip pack to get paid for it. And then EFS checks in case you need a lumper at a customer. Always have these with you, and Dart will provide you with these go see permits or talk to your fleet manager at your terminal. Just make sure you always have plenty of these on hand. This is always a good thing to have, your road atlas. Now, you know, don't go to your Walmart and get your $20 car atlas. Go to a truck stop or find one online. Get a good name brand. Rand McNally's a good one. And get yourself a nice trucker's road atlas. This has a lot of good info in it. These range in price. They're usually about $50. They can get up to $100 just depending where you're buying them at, but they're well worth it. Tough construction. They're laminated. You can use dry erase marker on here, and they got tons of info in it about height clearances, restricted routes, DOT phone numbers, hazmat phone numbers, all kinds of good stuff in here. I'll try to make a map video later. There are good map videos online, but I'll just try to make a simple one for Dart. But this is one thing you should always have, even though we are in a world of technology. You know, you got your GPS and your phone and all that, but you never know when that stuff's going to fail. The PeopleNet unit has gone down before, and you know, you don't have a good mount for your phone, or your phone GPS isn't working, you're in an area with no service. How do you know where you're going to get going? Well, you got your road atlas here. This is always going to be there for you as long as you go out and buy one. Every trucker should have one of these. If you don't have a road atlas, well, people might make fun of you for being a rookie trucker. Go out and buy yourself a road atlas. It's always good to have one. Another thing about the Volvos is that it'll automatically do the regens for you, but if there ever is a warning, it'll be on your visor here. You can check out which warning it is. And if you need to force park a regen, the icon will have to appear on the dash. Now I know sometimes the engine will do a fault and it'll go into D-rate mode. If you call up Road Ready and they say do a regen, It won't work unless there's an icon up on there, so let them know that. But if you need to do a forced regen, you just make sure you're parked, it's in neutral, switches on, and you hit request park regen. And then it'll go through the functions, make sure everything's good for that, and then it'll do the regen. If there ever is a fault, it'll be in the status menu, and that'll let you know what requirement you haven't met to do a parked regen. Another thing with the DEF tank too, especially in the winter time, you might have problems with your DEF pump. Now, of course, buying the jugs in the store is an alternative if you need to get DEF, but if you're at the pump, what I found out, what helps when the pump ain't working too good, is if you stick the pump in at an angle like this and just stick it in halfway and slowly pull up on the nozzle about halfway, you can usually get the DEF pump to work and pump some DEF in there. That's usually what I found out to work. I mean, sometimes you gotta angle it a different way, but if you put it in about halfway and slowly squeeze up on that handle, not all the way, but just about halfway, it's gonna take a while to fill, but at least you can get some DEF in there, or enough to get you rolling again until you get to a better pump. Sometimes even in the summertime, if you get a bad DEF pump, it won't work too good, but that's usually a hint if you're ever stuck out there and you need to fill up with DEF and you're having problems with the pump. And give that a try, see if it'll help you out. Another thing you should be aware of if you're going to idle your truck at night, and to prevent the idle shutdown, to kick up the idle, all you have to do is just take the cruise control, flip that over to resume, and the idle should kick up, and so should the oil pressure. Help keep the cylinders lubricated, so there's good oil pressure there too. But yeah, just kick her up and RPM should go up, and that'll kick it into clean idle mode if you're going to idle your truck.